Okay, good morning, everyone. It is my great pleasure to be here. First, I'd like to thank the organizer for giving me this wonderful opportunity to speak at this workshop. So what I'm going to talk about today is critical mechanical structures, by which we mean structures that are close to mechanical instability. And we will talk about aspects including topology and entropy. Okay, so first let me give you an outline and also acknowledge my collaborators. So the first part, I'm going to give you an introduction to critical mechanical structures, and then I will talk about our first part, that is on topological transitions and the general classification of critical mechanical structures. This is done in collaboration with my postdoc, Zeb Rocklin, who is on the market this year and is really excellent, and my undergraduate student, Shangnan Zhou, and my colleague, Kai Sun. And here is our newly posted manuscript on this work. And next, I will talk about critical mechanical structures at finite temperature. So I will talk about the interplay between entropy and the topology and the floppy modes. This is done in collaboration with Anton Suslov, Carlos Mendoza, Tom Lubinsky, and my student Le Yu Zhang and Vincenzo Vitelli. And here are the two papers related to this work. Okay, so let me start with the introduction. So to understand the critical mechanical structures, it is really central to first introduce the concept of floppy modes, which are modes of deformation of a system that cost little energy. So let me explain that first using a very simple example of granular materials. So here we have granular particles that are packed in a hopper, and I'm showing two different states. In the first state, the particles are jammed, and you see these paths that shows the force chains in the system because they use photoelastic particles. And on the right, it's not jammed, and the particles are flowing. The difference is that if you calculate the eigenmodes of the motion of the particles, then all of the eigenmodes here have positive eigenvalues. That means it costs positive elastic energy to move any particles around. Okay? And on the right,
on the left side, there are particles we're not seeing because they're not emphasized.
Right. It's packed.
Yes.
You're only seeing the ones that bear force. Okay? So the difference is that on the right, if you now calculate the eigenmodes, there are a number of modes that has zero eigenvalue, so that leads to the flow of these particles. So this is kind of obvious, right? So now you see that the concept of floppy modes is very important in soft matter because it tells you about the critical state between a solid-like state and a liquid-like state. So that's important in soft matter.
When you say you're computing the eigenmodes, what are you linearizing and then computing?
You can write down a harmonic form of the elastic energy in terms of the displacements of the different components. I will talk more about that later. Yeah. So, of course, this is not limited to soft matter. So, next, let me show you one example of how we can use floppy modes to make novel materials. And this is about mechanical metamaterials, by which we mean novel materials that have exotic properties that you gain from their structure rather than the composition of the material. So let me show you one example. This is the oxetic mechanical metamaterial, which means these materials have negative Poisson's ratio. What that means is that normally if you take a material and compress in this direction, it will expand in the other direction, right? But in engineering, it's sometimes of interest to have materials when you compress this way, they contract in the other way. And this is one example of structure that can realize this using the floppy mode. This is the so-called inverted honeycomb lattice, and the floppy mode of this lattice is that it contracts in both directions, okay? And this has been used to make real samples of mechanical metamaterials. Okay, so let me show you one last example of why floppy modes are interesting. So that this is about machine and the robot mechanisms. So here I'm showing you one simple example of a robot mechanism that is designed by Dutch artist Theo Hansen for walking. So the point is that this structure has only one floppy mode. That is the mechanism that you can use to direct the actuation that is happening here to the correct part that you want the motion, right? So if you actuate on the motion on this circle, you can make the robot to walk like this. And this is one example of the artwork of Theo Hansen, that is a robot that walks by wind power on sand beach, okay? So now you've seen many examples of floppy modes. Let me give you a little quiz. How many mechanisms or, say, floppy modes are there in your bike? Let's ignore the small ones, like you can change the height of the seat or you can use a brake. But just the big motion, how many floppy modes are there? Is there some guess? Two. Any other answer? Yeah, we ignore the rigid body motion of the whole thing, just the relative motion of different parts. We call those mechanisms.
Is this supposed to roll without slipping?
Yeah, that's an important point. So if you put it on a road, there are only two mechanisms that the whole thing can roll and go forward, and there is another, the turning of the direction. If you take it off the road, there are three mechanisms. The rotation of the rear wheel that is coupled to the pedals, and the rotation of the front wheel that is independent if you don't put it on a road, right? And also the change of direction. Okay, so now you see that.
Question.
Yes?
Because I can pedal backwards.
Yeah, that's right. That is a ratchet. So if you go forward, they're coupled. If you go backward, they're not coupled. So yeah, if you allow that, they are four.
But isn't it, but what do you call that? That's not the backwards one.
Mm-hmm.
So you can have a mode which looks like it's the same thing. So the thing about that walking robot.
Yes.
You have that thing going around clockwise.
Uh-huh.
If you went around counterclockwise, it would just walk backwards.
It could be, but it's not totally symmetric, the forward and backward.
Oh, I see.
I mean, this cycle is not symmetric in the two directions. So I'm not sure if it will really work the other way. Yeah, maybe it will. Okay, so now you see that for a small system, you can just poke around and see how many mechanisms are there, right? Then, but as physicists, we want to extract the rules, right? So if I gave you a very complex, a large system, how can you tell how many floppy modes are there, right? And this was first studied by Maxwell, and he wrote down a simple equation like this. So you take the total number of degrees of freedom of your system and subtract the number of constraints. So this is very simple, right? That gave you the number of zero modes in your system. And Maxwell did say that all of the constraints need to be independent of each other. So each of them fix a degrees of freedom. So what is left are the zero modes. So later, by Kaladine, who added a new term to this equation, that is state of self-stress, that takes care of the fact that some constraints may be redundant. So now, if you add this term, you don't need to distinguish redundant and non-redundant constraints. So I will explain the meaning of this later. But before that, let me relate this to floppy modes. So this N naught gives you the total number of zero modes in your whole system. That includes both mechanisms or floppy modes that are the relative motions, right? And also the trivial rigid body motion of the whole thing. If you want mechanisms, you want to subtract this FD from your N naught. This FD is a simple number. It is 3 in 2 dimensions, corresponding to 2 translations and 1 rotation. And there are 6 of them in 3 dimensions. Okay. So next, let me use a simple example to illustrate this equation. Here I have 6 particles in 2 dimensions. So they are point-like particles. So the whole system has 12 degrees of freedom. And the rigid body trivial degrees of freedom is 3 of the whole thing. So now in the first example, I have 8 constraints. And if I put this in the equation here, I don't have any states of self-stress. What you will get is that there are 4 zero modes. And one of them is a non-trivial one that corresponds to changing the shape of the placket here. And now if I add one more bond, that is one more constraint, and that will eliminate the floppy mode. So these are very simple. And the interesting case is the third one, if you add the last bond in the wrong place, it doesn't remove the floppy mode. What it does is that it introduces a state of self-stress on the plaquette on the left. What that means is that now I can have tension or compression on the bonds, but the net force on each of the sides is still zero. So that is a self-stress. It doesn't couple to any external force. So now the equation goes like I have one state of self-stress, and the constraint is 9, but I get one mechanism corresponding to this one. Okay? So now, in general, mechanical stability corresponds to the state where you don't have any mechanisms, so the whole thing is stable. And on another hand, if you want your structure to be stress-free, then you don't want to have this kind of thing. Because if you have this, and if any of the bond is not having perfectly correct length, you are introducing stress to your structure. And engineers usually don't want that, right? And the special state of isostaticity corresponds to the state where the structure is both stable and stress-free. This is important in engineering because engineers want to make their structure both stable and they don't have stress when they're at rest. Okay? So in condensed matter physics, we are often interested in collective behaviors of large systems, right? So it is useful to derive this equation of balancing degrees of freedom and constraint for a large system, so we can write a local version of it and study collective behavior. So to do that, let's consider a simple large system consisting of point-like particles and central force bonds. So each of the particle contribute d degrees of freedom, and each of the bond contribute one constraint because it fixed the distance between the two ends, right? And then if in your system, on average, the coordination number is z, by coordination number, we mean the number of bonds connecting to one particle, then you can easily get that the average number of constraints per particle is z divided by 2, because each bond is shared by 2 particles, right? And now if you want to balance the number of degrees of freedom and the number of constraints for mechanical stability, you can equal this term and this term, right? So that gives you the critical condition of z equal to 2d for mechanical stability in a large system of point-like particles and central force bonds. So this looks to be a very simple prediction, right? Totally mean field. But it actually has a lot of predicting power. So let me give you 2 examples of why it works very well. The first example is the rigidity percolation transition. So what that means is that you can start from a perfect lattice that is over-constrained. So here I'm using the example of triangular lattice. It's 6 coordinated, so it doesn't have any floppy mode. But now I randomly take off bonds from this lattice, and then I can ask the question, when does it lose rigidity? So at some point, if you shear the lattice or if you compress it, it doesn't carry the stress, it will collapse. Right, so we can ask, when does this transition happen? And it has been studied a lot in 1980s and the 90s, and it has been found that the critical point is about 0.66 of where this p is the probability for having each bond. So this is a numerical value, right? But you can also make a simple mean field guess from this equation, because you can guess that the critical point happens when the average z is equal to 2d, right? That is 4 in 2 dimensions. And the average coordination in this particular lattice is 6 times p, because 6 is the maximum coordination. So if you want 6 times p to be 4, then p should be 2/3. That's very, very close to where the actual transition is. Okay, so this is how you use this equation to predict the rigidity percolation. And let me next, yes.
Is it different from, can you do the numerics accurately enough to know that it's not exactly 2/3?
Right. It's actually 0.6601 plus like 2 times 10 to the power of minus 4. So they are different outside of the arrow. Right. And the point is that this is smaller than what is needed. What happens is that you have a fractal backbone that carries the stress. So you don't have the whole, you don't need to have the whole system stable everywhere. You just need to have a backbone to carry a percolating backbone for the stress. Okay, so let me show you another example, which is slightly more complicated. So that is an example of jamming of frictionless particles. So here I have a collection of frictionless spherical particles, and I assume they don't interact unless they contact. Now, if the density of the particle is low, then the whole system is in a liquid-like state. There are lots of floppy modes. You can move things around. But now, if I quickly compress the system together, there is a sharp transition at a critical concentration of the particles where the system will self-organize into an amorphous state that carries stress. So it's a solid-like state. And numerically, this has been studied a lot. And people found that at this critical point, if you count the coordination number of your network, it is exactly z equal to 2d. So that completely agrees with the prediction you can get from simple counting. Okay. So and these two states correspond to the two states I showed in the beginning, where they're unjammed or they are jammed. Okay. So we are theorists, and we want to do some analytic calculation on the
are those results still, I mean, that result is for frictionless particles.
That's right.
Right.
This is not an exact correspondence. In this experiment, there are friction, but I'm just showing you the simple concept of jamming and unjamming. Okay, so next we are going to apply this equation to periodic lattices, because you know with periodic lattices, you can easily do exact calculations and controlled approximations. So what we want to do is to use lattice models to benchmark the phenomena. We can predict what kind of phenomena you are going to see as different types of system approach mechanical instability, right? So let's first see what happens to periodic lattices. Using this equation, you can classify lattices, right? This is very simple to do. If a lattice is undercoordinated, like the honeycomb lattice, here I assume there are only nearest neighbor central force interaction. So this lattice is undercoordinated, and there are a lot of floppy modes, extensive number of floppy modes, corresponding to the rotation of each of the hexagons. And in another extreme, if the lattice has z greater than 2d, then they are overcoordinated, and there are no floppy modes. In the middle, there are all these interesting lattices, which we now call Maxwell lattices, which have exactly z equal to 2d. This includes square lattice and Kagami lattice in 2d, and cubic lattice and paraclaw lattices in three dimensions. There are many more. I'm just showing some examples. So it is one interesting question to ask, how many floppy modes are there in these lattices? So this is like a first step towards understanding how many universality classes are there as different complicated structures approach mechanical instability, right? We can start with periodic lattices and see what are the different behaviors. So let's start from a simple example. If I have a finite piece of a square lattice that has z equal to 2d, how many floppy modes do I have? So if I have open boundary condition, it's obvious that the particles on the boundary have fewer constraints, right? So as a result, I have the number of floppy modes I have is proportional to the perimeter of the system. So what are the floppy modes of the square lattice? It's not difficult to see, right? They are the modes that you can translate each of the rows and the columns without extending any bound. This is a floppy mode. And the number of these is proportional to the number of rows and the columns. So that's a sub-extensive number. And now if I have fixed boundary condition, then all of them are lifted, right? But the interesting case is when I have periodic boundary conditions, how many floppy modes do I have? And by naive counting, you would say there are no floppy modes because this condition is satisfied everywhere. But then if you take a closer look at this mode, you will see that it is consistent with periodic boundary condition, because what this particle does is the same as what this particle does. Although it shrinks a little bit on the top, but that is a higher order effect. this is a second order, this is a first order, right? So to leading order theory, it is a floppy mode still in periodic boundary conditions. Then you can ask why this lattice in periodic boundary condition, although the counting is satisfied everywhere, why it still has floppy modes, right? And then you can ask, does this always happen? Do you always have extra floppy modes when the system is under periodic boundary condition? So first, to understand why you have floppy modes, you can probably already guess the answer, right? We had an equation like this. You need to add the states of self-stress, which tells you that the system sometimes has redundant bounds. So in the case of the square lattice, each of the row and the column bear a state of self-stress. That is, you can put in compression on each of the bound, and the whole thing is still stable. So that is a state of self-stress under periodic boundary condition. And that gives you one floppy mode for each row and each column. And if you plot the phonon dispersion relation of this lattice, you will see a zero frequency line in your first Brillouin zone between the zero wave number to the boundary. Okay, and the solid line is that if you add next nearest neighbor bounds to the lattice, you can stabilize it and stabilize the floppy modes. Okay, so then the second question is, does this always happen in all kinds of lattices that has z equal to 2d, right? So to answer that, we looked at many different lattices, and the answer is that some lattices have this phenomenon and some lattices don't. So here I'm showing the example of a Kagame lattice, which is also four-coordinated. And this lattice also have the state of self-stress because it has the straight lines of bounds. So as a result, you have floppy modes in each row like this, and they show up in the phonon spectrum as a zero-frequency line.
Can you explain that phonon spectrum? What are the x and y axes there?
OK, yeah, so this axis is wave number, so they correspond to the points in the first Brillouin zone of the momentum space of the lattice, and this axis is frequency of the mode. Okay, but if you change the geometry a little bit, if you twist up this lattice, which means you keep the bound length the same, but you change the angle between the triangles, then you get a twisted Kagame lattice. And what you do is now you lift up all the states of self-stress. And this lattice under periodic boundary condition doesn't have any floppy mode. So you see that this phenomena really depend on the geometry of your system, right? And then this all makes sense under periodic boundary condition, right? Here you have states of self-stress that correspond to floppy mode. But then you can ask an interesting question. If I have this lattice under open boundary condition, what are the floppy modes? Because under open boundary condition, it has to have the correct number of floppy modes by counting. But they don't show up in periodic boundary condition. They are inconsistent with periodic boundary condition. So what are these modes? This puzzled us for a while, but later we found out that these modes are not plane waves. Instead, they are edge modes, and they are described by conformal transformations in this lattice. So I will talk a little more about this later, but let me just show you one example of the floppy mode of this lattice. Here I have periodic boundary condition in x direction and open boundary condition in the y direction. And here I'm showing you one example of the floppy mode. You see that it has a lot of distortions on the top edge, but it decays quickly into the bulk. So that is a floppy mode that lives on this edge. And now if we step back a little bit, you can ask the question, how can we tell if a lattice has floppy modes in their bulk, or if the lattice should have floppy modes on the edge, right? And you can ask a more general question, how many classes of behaviors as all kinds of complicated structures approach mechanical instability? How can we predict how many floppy modes do you have, and where do these floppy modes arise, right? So we will address this question in later part of the talk. So now in the last part of my introduction, I'm going to talk about a new discovery by Charlie King and Lubinsky. What they found is that in deformed Kagame lattice, so by deformed Kagame lattice, this is a lattice that has the same connectivity as the Kagami lattice, but now the bond lengths are not all equal to one. You change the shape of the triangles. And the interesting phenomena in this lattice is that now the floppy modes are edge modes, and now these edge modes can get focused on particular edges and leave the opposite edge to be rigid. So here in this lattice, these plots tell you about the phonon dispersion relations in different directions. And this plot tells you that the top edge is rigid because there is no floppy mode here, it is gapped. And this plot tells you that in this edge, there are two branches of floppy modes. So the floppy modes that are originally here now appear in the bottom edge. And on the right, on the left, it is still one branch of floppy mode. So this is in direct contrast to the phenomena we see in the simple twisted Kagame, where you have floppy modes around all of the edges. Here in this case, the floppy modes got focused on the bottom edge, right? And this is actually controlled by the topological structure of the phonon bands of this deformed Kagame lattice. And this is characterized by a topological polarization RT that points to the direction where floppy edge modes are concentrated on. So let me spend one more slide to explain how this works. So in this paper by King and Lubinsky, they proposed this index theorem for topological phonons. So this index is the difference between the number of zero modes and the number of states of self-stress in a subregion S in your lattice. And this equation tells you that there are two different components that give you this index. The first component is a local term, so that it simply comes from counting within this region the number of degrees of freedom and the number of constraints, right? And the second term is a topological term that is controlled by this topological polarization RT. And what this is from is what controls this RT is the winding number of the phase of this determinant of this equilibrium matrix that tells you the elastic interactions in your lattice. So this is a topologically protected quantity. And how it works is that if you want to know about the edge modes on a particular edge of your lattice, you can do an integral within a subregion that encloses this edge. So now, because the topological polarization of this lattice points into this subregion, it receives an extra topological contribution to your index of floppy modes in this region. So if this lattice has RT pointing to it, it gains extra floppy modes. And on the opposite side, it loses floppy modes, okay? Yes, RT is a vector. These are the primitive vectors of the lattice, yes. Okay, so this is my introduction to, yes, okay.
CI
is the contours on the first Brillouin zone. So you calculate winding numbers of this phase on your Brillouin zone.
So this is all in a two-dimensional lattice, is that right?
Yes, a two-dimensional lattice. And you calculated the phonon structure in momentum space.
So it's on the torus, right?
Yes.
Right, so
yeah.
You're just calculating the winding around the two cycles.
Oh, I see.
That's right, yeah.
Okay,
yeah, yeah.
All right.
Okay, so it is like the phonon structure of this lattice develops a non-trivial topology that tells you the floppy modes has to focus on particular edges. That's how it works. Okay, so that is the introduction of my talk. And now let's get to the first part. So here, the we are trying to address two different questions in this project. The first question is, can we have topological transitions between different states, between different topological states in mechanical systems? So these topological transitions has been studied a lot in quantum topological states of matter. For example, you can change magnetic field and change the topological states in quantum Hall systems, right? And we can ask, can you do the same thing in mechanical systems? And the second question we want to answer is the question I mentioned earlier. Is there a general classification of all kinds of structures that approach mechanical instability? Can we predict where the floppy modes are going to be, right? And like for a generic experimental system, can we say which class it belongs to? So let's start from the first question. This is kind of challenging because we said that this topological polarization is protected by the topology of the phonon structure of the whole lattice, right? So it is robust to any local change. So we must introduce any global change to your structure in order to have a topological transition. And interestingly, it turns out that there is a very easy way to introduce a global change to these lattices. And this is, the way you can do it is using the guest modes, which are introduced in by Guest and Hutchinson in this paper, 2000. In this paper, they proved a theorem that is, all two-dimensional periodic lattices, if they are four-coordinated, then there must be at least one uniform deformation that is soft. By soft, what they mean is that if the lattice has only nearest neighbor interactions, central force interactions, then there must be a uniform deformation that is of zero elastic energy. So here is one example in their paper. This is a four-coordinated, it is a pretty much like a deformed square lattice, right? What the theorem says is that you can mess up the geometry whatever you want, right? You must have this floppy deformation as long as the lattice is periodic and four-coordinated. So the two different colors shows before and after the deformation. This deformation is soft because all of the bond length remain the same. It is only the angle that changes. Okay, so in this work, we are going to call these deformations uniform soft twistings. We are going to use these to introduce topological transitions. So let me first show you a few more examples of the uniform soft twisting. So if you do this on a Kagame lattice, you can twist it up this way or twist it up the other way, right? These are all floppy deformations. And if you apply it on a square lattice, that is a deformed square lattice, you can also twist it from this extreme to that extreme, right? Here we can use this theta, which is a bound angle, to label all the states along this coordinate. And we know that z equal to 2d is a sufficient condition for a periodic lattice to have such a soft deformation. So now we know that we have this soft deformation. We can apply it on a lattice that is known to have this topological structure, right? So we take one example of a deformed Kagame lattice, and what the uniform soft twisting does is that it changes the bound angles. You can plot all the states like this. And then we went ahead and calculated the topological structure along this coordinate. What we see is that indeed it can change the topological state. So here along this coordinate, there are three critical angles corresponding to these three states. Outside of this region, the lattice is non-polarized. So you have floppy modes around all of the edges. And within this region, there are two different states where the topological polarization pointing to this direction and pointing to this direction, telling you that this edge or this edge gets more floppy modes, and the bottom edge becomes rigid. So you can use this uniform soft deformation to transform a lattice between different topological state. Okay. So let me explain a little more what really happens at this transition. So here I'm using the example of theta 2. I'm drawing the evolution of a pair of floppy mode in this lattice. Here I have periodic boundary condition in x direction and open boundary in y. So I'm drawing a pair of floppy mode, the red arrows and the black arrows. In the non-topologically polarized state, the two floppy modes live on the top and the bottom edge separately. Right? Now if I start to expand this lattice, the penetration depth of this floppy mode increase and increase and until it goes to infinity at the critical state. So it becomes a bulk floppy mode. And after that, it gets transferred to the top edge. So this is how the topological transition happens. And now all the floppy modes are focused on the top edge in this lattice. And now here, this is theta greater than theta 2. And this is described by the topological polarization RT. Here we numerically calculated the stiffness of the edge. And what you see is that this curve is for the bottom edge. The stiffness of this bottom edge can increase by many orders of magnitude if you introduce this transition. Because before, it has a lot of floppy modes, and the stiffness is essentially zero. But after the transition, it's as rigid as the bulk. But the other edge still remains floppy. So this gives us an idea that we can design new materials that you have greater controllability of the rigidity by many orders of magnitude, right? Oh, and I'd like to point out an interesting analogy. So these two states before and after the transition are like two insulating states with different topologies. And in the middle, the state is analogous to a metal because it has floppy modes cross the bulk. So it is like a conducting state. OK, so next to.
Yes. The atomic version, they usually talk about attaching one to the other.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So how would you do that here?
Can you
adiabatically change theta from less than theta 2 to more than theta 2 in one sample, or is it just too gross down the middle?
I think you can do that. Right, you know, in the paper of Kay and Lubinsky, they show gluing two different lattices together, and you have a metal state in between. That is like an extreme version. You just glue two different lattices together, but you can gradually change it if you want in this lattice. Yeah. Okay, so next let me show you one movie we made to demonstrate this effect. Here we made a deformed Kagame lattice using connects. So if you look at this picture, there are three different components. Let me pause the movie a little bit. OK, so the different components are the rigid connectors and the rods and the hinges. So the connectors are rigid. So each of the connector give you a rigid triangle. So there are two types of triangles because we choose different angles. And these connection points are free hinges. Okay, so this gives you a mechanical deformed Kagame lattice. And in this demonstration, in the first part, the lattice is in a non-polarized state. You see the both of the edges are very floppy. If you push, it just deform in, right? That is because both of the edges have a lot of floppy modes that can accommodate the local deformation. And in the second demonstration, we show that you can introduce a topological transition using the uniform soft twisting of the lattice. So this is a soft deformation. We are only changing the angles at the hinges. So it's very easy to do. You just dilate the lattice. Right? And at this point, the topological transition happens. And after that, you develop a topological polarization in this direction. And as a result, all the floppy modes on this edge get transferred to the top edge. So this edge becomes very rigid. You will see the effect of that in the third part of the demonstration. So here now, what we do is that you poke on the bottom edge. Now the bottom edge becomes very rigid. If you push on it, it doesn't deform. Instead, the whole structure just goes up. It can sustain stress. And this has nothing to do with stretching the structure out. Right? These are free boundaries. We don't exert any stress. This is really controlled by the topological structure of your vibrational modes. And the top edge is floppy. Okay, so now in this demonstration, we showed the effect that you can change the edge stiffness by many orders of magnitude by using this topological transition. Okay, so we think it is a promising idea to make transformable mechanical metamaterials because it can give you both the transitions and also very interesting property that one edge is rigid, the other edge is soft. So next, let me try to explain why this is useful. Right? If we can compare two different approaches to get a material that is one edge soft, one edge rigid. You can do it in a very simple way, right? You can cover metal with a rubber so that this side is soft, this side is hard. For example, this can be useful, for example, if you want a structure that can absorb impact in this side and protect the interior on this side, for example, like in your tire, right? But this approach has disadvantages. One disadvantage is that if the rubber wear out, then the protection is gone. And the other is that you can't switch the stiffness. It is made there, right? If we use this new design using the topological transitions, what you see is that this is very robust. If the top layer of this lattice wears off, then the newly exposed layer will become soft because it is dictated by the topological structure. And on another hand, you can switch it. You can make both sides soft. So this may be an interesting idea to make a new material. Okay. So that is answering our first question, can you have topological transitions? So now let's get to the second question. I think I have 15 minutes. So that is, we want to understand how many universality classes are there when structures approach mechanical instability. So let's first focus on structures that have this uniform soft twisting. These are actually very large categories of structures because all of the structures, if they are Maxwell lattices, if they satisfy this z equal to 2d, then they are guaranteed to have such a soft deformation, right? And it also includes other structures. For example, if the lattice is over-coordinated, but if you get the geometry right, you can have the correct number of states of self-stress, and you still have this floppy, this uniform soft twisting. Here, I call this an over-coordinated lattice because these colored plaquettes are rigid, and to make them rigid, you need to have bonds on the edges of it and also a diagonal one. Right? So that makes the coordination of each of the lattice side here to be 5. So that's above the isostatic, above the z equal to 2d point. Okay. So the approach we are going to take to show this classification is that we can start from the fact that this lattice has a uniform soft twisting. And we find that if it has this, then you can show that there are a series of waves that are also floppy. And the character of this uniform soft twisting will determine the characters of this wave. You can find, in some cases, they are bulk modes. So the floppy modes are plane waves. And in some other cases, they are edge modes. So they are surface waves. And then from this character, you can learn a little bit of whether the lattice can have a topological transition or not. OK, so to do that, let me first use one slide to remind you of the basics of nonlinear elasticity. So here, if I have an elastic medium, I can label all the points in this elastic medium by this lowercase r. And after a deformation, each of the points is mapped to a new position, that is capital R. Right? To describe this deformation, you can introduce this deformation gradient, that is the derivative of this. And you know that this looks like a tensor, but it is not because the two indices are in two different spaces. What that means is that if you do a rotation before your deformation or you do a rotation after your deformation, it can result in different deformations, right? So to make it into a true tensor, you need to contract it correctly. And what you can write down this metric tensor, which is a tensor in the original space. And the index in this space is are contracted. And if you don't do any deformation, then you get identity matrix for this, right? So to describe the deformation, you can subtract that trivial part. And this epsilon is the strain tensor that is proportional to how much it is deformed. Now, if I want to write down an elastic energy of the system, I can write it as a serious expansion in terms of this strain tensor. And if there is no pre-stress in the structure, then this serious expansion starts from the second order term, right? So here the C, I, J, K, L are the elastic constants. If you have symmetry, then you can reduce the number of these. But now let's just keep the most general form. And you can also write higher order terms. And now with this formulation, we can write the uniform soft twisting as a strain tensor. Right? This is a soft strain tensor. Because it is soft, then it must satisfy the condition that if you put it in this form, it gives you zero. Okay? So next, you can then immediately get that if you multiply this strain by an arbitrary scalar function and plug it back into this equation, you still get a floppy deformation. That is because you have this uniform soft twisting that is soft, right? You can do this in different magnitude in different places. And the elastic energy cost is going to be higher order because that is going to depend on how the spatial variation of this deformation you do. So then we know that you can have a series of spatially varying deformation that is also soft. But we have to be careful because not all arbitrary scalar functions give you an actual deformation. You're using too many degrees of freedom, right? To make sure that is a true deformation, we need to impose extra conditions on this scalar function. That is, your deformation must be a deformation from a flat space to a flat space. And if you solve these equations, what you will find is that the scalar function must have this particular form that is a wave in a particular direction. So you must have a combination between x and y directions. This looks kind of complicated, but let me just draw your attention to this term that is the square root of the determinant of the strain tensor of this uniform soft twisting. So this is a quantity that doesn't depend on the coordinate you choose. Right? And from this, you see that there are two different classes of behaviors. One is when this determinant is positive. That corresponds to when the uniform soft twisting is mainly a dilation deformation, so which means it changes the volume more than it changes the shape. In this case, you get an imaginary lambda. That corresponds to the fact that these floppy modes are surface waves. Because this imaginary part of lambda tells you that if you propagate a wave in the x direction, it's going to decay in the y direction from the imaginary part, right? So that gives you surface waves. On another and of course, in this case, it happens that the structure must be oxetic. That means they have negative Poisson's ratio. And on another hand, if this is negative, then you get real solutions of lambda. And this corresponds to plane waves. So these floppy modes are in the bulk. So now using this elasticity theory, we can now classify structures that have uniform soft twisting. And I'd like to point out that this is a purely like a low energy elasticity theory, so that's independent of macroscopic details. As long as you have a uniform soft twisting, you can apply this, right? So then here is our classification of structures. I know this is a very complicated table, so let me first focus on the dilation dominant regime. In this regime, as I said, if you propagate a wave in x direction, it must decay in the other direction. And the decay rate is controlled by the imaginary part. So now the bulk of the system is rigid. If you plot the phonon spectrum, this is the frequency of phonons in the first Lagrangian zone. It's stable in all directions. And there must be floppy edge waves. And these floppy modes live on all of the edges because you can choose the direction of x arbitrarily. No matter which direction you choose, you always get decaying surface waves. And in some special cases, they are described by conformal transformations. And the top part of this table is all from the elasticity theory that are independent of macroscopic details. Now, if you know a little more about the macroscopic structure, like if you know the coordination number, then you can have more information. For example, if you know it is a Maxwell lattice, then you can know that these floppy modes must be of exactly zero energy. Right. Instead, the elasticity theory only tell you that they are zero energy to leading order. So this is the deletion dominant regime. And the shear dominant regime is that your solution gave you plane waves in the bulk. So now you have floppy plane waves in two directions. You can see it from here. And on the edge, two different things can happen. One is that the floppy modes are really in the bulk. Right. The other thing is there can be higher order terms that were not covered by our theory, and the edge modes are actually living on the edge of the system, and they can be controlled by the topological polarization, so they can get focused on particular edges. So this is a necessary condition for the system to have a topologically polarized state, and in this deletion dominant case, it cannot be polarized because you must have floppy modes in all of the edges. And again, if you know more about the macroscopic detail, you can say more like whether these floppy modes are exact zero energy or not. Okay, so now with this information of the classification, we can look at the example of the deformed Kagame lattice again. Now, if you transform the lattice along the uniform soft twisting, now in addition to the three topological transitions, you can have additional transitions where the lattice change from deletion dominant to shear dominant. And what our theorem tell you is that being shear dominant is a necessary condition for having topological transitions. And you see that there are narrow regions where the lattice is shear dominant, but they are not topological. They still have floppy modes on all of the edges. Okay, so the last part, I'd like to say a little more about the conformal transformations. So this happens in the case of twisted Kagame lattice, because in the twisted Kagame lattice, this uniform soft twisting happens to be an isotropic dilation in all directions. So as a result, if you plug in these equations, you will find that lambda is simply plus or minus I. And then if you write down the form of your spatially varying floppy modes, they are simply complex analytic functions. And this tells you that the floppy modes in this lattice are described by conformal transformations. So that's kind of an interesting limit. So this is generally true if any lattice has zero bulk modulus. You don't need to know the macroscopic structure. As long as the bulk modulus is zero, you can change the volume freely. You must have these floppy modes described by conformal transformations. Okay, so that's the second part. I think I have like 5 minutes. Let me slightly touch the last part of my talk on thermal fluctuations. So the idea is that we all know that in ordinary phase transitions, you have one instability toward the development of a long-range order. So that is one floppy mode that says that the system should want to develop a long-range order as you lower temperature, right? And the result of that floppy mode is that you get divergent fluctuations because these modes are free to excite. And these divergent fluctuations will overwhelm any macroscopic details. And as a result, you have universality classes. So now it's interesting to think about the same question in these mechanical structures, because in these mechanical structures, you often have a large number of floppy modes that arise at the same point. So now you have the computation of the fluctuations along all of these modes, and there can be interesting things happening from this computation between the different modes. Right. So to capture that phenomenon, we studied a very simple model, that is a square lattice with next nearest neighbor bounds. But on the next nearest neighbor bounds, we have springs that have double well potential. So the control parameter is this kappa. If kappa is positive, then this lattice is stable, right? The next nearest neighbor bounds just prefer to have length square root of 2. If this becomes negative, it becomes a double well potential, and the two ground state, the each of the plaquette have two ground states. It can either lean to the right or lean to the left. Then as a result, for the whole lattice, it breaks into exponentially many ground states, because at each of the row, you can choose left or right. So now it is kind of an interesting model that you have a transition at zero temperature where you tune the system from one unique ground state to exponentially many ground state. It is a little bit like glass transition, right? And now we can ask the question, if we turn on thermal fluctuations, what is going to happen? So in particular, you can ask two types of questions. One is, at a kappa negative, there are exponentially many ground state. Does thermal fluctuations choose one of them or not? Which one is preferred? And the other question is, what is the stability boundary of this phase? If you change kappa from positive to negative at a finite temperature, where does the transition happen? So it turns out that the first question is relatively easy. You can just calculate the phonon entropy of these different lattices. And there is an order by disorder effect, which means all of these states are degenerate, but the are degenerate in potential energy, but the entropy is different. So entropy is the highest in this uniformly tilted state. So by order by disorder, the system will choose this state. And the second question is, so we answer the first question. The second question is slightly more complicated. So now we have to really consider the fact that you have a large number of floppy modes in this lattice. And when you have finite temperature, they all contribute to the correction to the shear rigidity. So what we did is that we analytically calculate the fluctuation correction to the shear rigidity to this lattice, and we also did Monte Carlo simulations. What is unique is, as I said, there are large numbers of floppy modes, so that give you a divergent contribution to the fluctuation correction. And as a result, we get a phase diagram for this lattice like this. The horizontal axis is the kappa, that is the second order coefficient for the next nearest neighbor interactions. The zero temperature transition happens here. And if you turn on temperature, the square lattice phase is going to be favored by thermal fluctuations. And the transition, you have a first order transition here from square to rhombic phase. And in the square lattice, there are different regimes where you have weird relations between the shear modulus and the temperature. Okay, so this is interplay between floppy modes and entropy in a regular lattice, which is not topological, right? So now our new project is to look at this effect in a lattice that has topological transitions. What kind of transition do you have, right? So this is very preliminary. We are still working on it. So we take this deformed Kagame lattice, and this axis is the uniform soft twisting coordinate. This is free energy. So what you see is that at these critical angles for topological transitions, because the lattice has a large number of floppy modes in the bulk, you will have kinks in your free energy. They give you a singular contribution to the lattice free energy. So the impact of that, what we think is that the lattice at a finite temperature, if there are no other interactions, they will favor to be at the critical state between different topological structures. And on another hand, if you add in other potential energy favoring certain angles, then the lattice will have a first order transition across a topological transition, right? And this can be a useful thing, because if you have a mechanical metamaterial using this, first order transition is kind of a sharp transition you can control very well. Okay, so this could be useful. Okay, so let me summarize. So we studied the topological transitions in critical mechanical structures, and these transitions give you dramatic change of mechanical properties. So from this, we are trying to propose this new concept of transformable topological mechanical metamaterials. And we also studied the general classification of all kinds of structures approaching mechanical instability. And you will see that depending on the structure, you can have floppy modes on the bulk or floppy modes on the edge. And in the end, we also talked about the interplay between entropy and floppy modes and topology. OK, thank you for your attention.